हेलो। हेलो स्वयं प्रकाश,
बोलो मैम।
जो हमारा वीडियो ना थी देखा तो कैमरा ऑन है
आवे छे मैडम, तमे ऑन जो तमने हमें जोई सकिए छे।
एवं छे तो पछी मारा सेटिंग में कहीं प्रॉब्लम जरूर
आ
थे।
डिस्कनेक्ट થઈને કનેક્ટ થઈ જાવ છો।
ઓકે તો ફરી મને એડ કરો। ચલો Hello sir, good afternoon.
Hello, good afternoon. Hope my voice is audible.
Yes, sir, you are perfectly audible.
Thank you. So, is it a right time? Shall we start?
Just 2-3 minutes. So, participants are already like some of the joining, some are in the joining process, sir.
Okay.
Just 2-3 minutes, sir. Okay. Meanwhile, no you problem. Can share your presentation, sir. No problem, sir.
Yeah, sure. Yes.
Give us 2-3 minutes so we can introduce you about our audience, sir.
Yeah, okay, fine.
Yes, Jagruti madam. I think we shall begin, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Good afternoon, all. Welcome to the Clauset Endowment Chair on Regulatory Considerations for Pharmaceutical Development, a Global Scenario. Organized by Ramanbhai Patel College of Pharmacy and T.P. Patel Center for Postgraduate Studies in Pharmacy, Charulhas University of Science and Technology. RPCP is a constituent institute of Charulhas University of Science and Technology. It was established in the year 2004 with a view to promote excellence in pharmacy education and to prepare the young talent to meet the challenges of industrial pharmacy and pharmacy practice. With this view, at RPCP, we organize Charulhas Endowment Chair every year with an objective to provide the platform to our students with for interaction with the eminent speakers, scientists or professionals. And this year we have organized it in the online mode. So for today's last day of Endowment Chair activity, for today's session, we have with us Dr. Jignesh Patel, Senior Director and Head Clinical Pharmacology and Core Laboratories, CBCC Global Research, Ahmedabad. Sir is having more than 17 years of experience in the pharmaceutical research. He has published more than 30 scientific articles in various scientific journals. He has received many national and international awards for his research work and scientific publications. He had worked with India's top pharmaceutical company, Sun Pharma's Research Center, as in charge of phase one clinical trial unit for more than 10 years and has contributed for the clinical development of various NCEs and NDDS products for USFDA, EMA, MHRA, and other regulatory filing. He is examiner for MD, DM, and DMD courses at NHL Medical College, MS University Medical College, Sterling Hospital, etc. And for MPharm courses at DD University, Nirma University, and many other pharmacy colleges. And today he is going to deliver a talk on role of clinical pharmacology in drug discovery and development, a regulatory perspective. I request, sir, for the session.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Ramanbhai Patel Pharmacy College team, my student Jagruti, Gayatri, and all the participants for giving me the opportunity to talk on the topic, role of clinical pharmacology in drug discovery and development. Now, as the topic title itself says, a role of clinical pharmacology in drug discovery and development, and from a regulatory perspective. So from title, you could depict that the science guides the regulator, like regulations. So it's a scientifically guided regulatory process of evaluating a drug. I would say evaluating a potential chemical or potential biological substance to be a drug, and to make an effort to launch it into the market for the betterment of the society, for the treatment of unmet need of the patient, and to improve the health. So let us start with the presentation. Okay, now any new drug, when it comes to the market, it undergoes a series of events. That series of research event we can categorize mainly in two parts: the drug discovery and the drug development. This drug discovery part, it is a very early stage of research involving a chemistry for chemical compounds, for biological synthesis, for biological compound, biological drug, and to optimize their structure in a way that it cause a desirable effect and also minimize the toxic effect. That particular research area is a part of a drug discovery. And once a particular compound or particular set of compound are identified, they are tested either in in animals, starting with the animals, from various tissues, in vitro or in vivo studies, followed by clinical trial. That entire process is called drug development. This drug discovery as well as drug development is totally, completely guided by many different scientific specialties. And one of the most important science which guide the drug discovery and the drug development is a clinical pharmacology. Clinical pharmacology as such is very, underrated or undermined area of a pharmaceutical research, but it's very, very important. In fact, a clinical pharmacology is a science which brings a drug from laboratory to the clinic. So you must have heard the terminologies: clinical research, clinical trial, clinical studies, or maybe a clinical development. But clinical pharmacology, it is something like we have heard during our college days, that's all, correct? But the clinical pharmacology is a science. Clinical research is a process. The clinical study or clinical trial is one of the project of that particular process, and clinical development is a complete set of event or a strategy which is carried out by pharmaceutical or medical researcher to make a drug available or make a drug approved by regulatory bodies for use into the market. Okay, so the science which supports the clinical research, clinical study, or clinical development, that science is a clinical pharmacology. Okay, now any drug's future in the market, it mainly depends on its performance in the target population. Okay, the target disease patient population. And the part of the research, part of a clinical development which is carried out in a target patient population, are the phase 2 or phase 3 clinical trial. So mainly based on the performance of a drug, especially in phase 2 and phase 3 trial, the drug's future depends. Okay, now in this entire process, starting from drug discovery to drug development, the clinical pharmacology is mainly or directly involved in a clinical development stage, that is starting from phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, as well as phase 4 clinical trial. The direct role, if we talk about clinical pharmacology science, is in clinical development. But it has an indirect or a supporting role in drug discovery phase also. How? That I will explain you. Now, during drug discovery phase, there are certain highly advanced studies which in some of the countries or in some of the pharmaceutical R&D centers are carried out. That studies are called microdose studies. Okay? That The science behind the microdose study is a clinical pharmacology science. Apart from all this, broader areas, if we look deep into drug development process, the clinical pharmacology is involved during a drug discovery, at the starting of the conceptualization of the therapy. Conceptualization of therapy is nothing but hypothesizing a particular biological cascade of entire mechanism where we can externally intervene and we can modify certain physiological processes in such a way that it can produce a beneficial effect into a disease conditions. So that entire conceptualization process is supported by a clinical pharmacology science. A study of a clinical appropriateness of a therapy, that is also supported by the clinical pharmacology science, because not all therapies are appropriate. There are many limitations of therapies, starting from patient's acceptability, patient's feasibility, medical system's feasibility. Okay, let's say for example in COVID-19, sanitizers can kill the COVID-19 virus, but can sanitizer be used to treat a patient? No, so it's not a feasible therapy, that kind of decision. The study of a clinical experience of already available drug of a similar class, that is a very important aspect of use of a clinical pharmacology science in drug discovery. To study a customer's, the patients as the customers, their requirement and their expectation with the product. For example, in pain, in headache, in fever, in diarrhea, or in acute asthmatic attack, the patient's needs a quick treatment, a treatment which produces the quick effect. While in hypercholesterolemia, diabetes, anemia, patient doesn't need a quick acting treatment, but patient need an effective treatment. So accordingly, the drug should be able to produce the therapeutic effect. So this is very important to understand when we conceptualize a therapy. We doesn't need to stress upon immediate effect for a patient like diabetes or hypercholesterolemia. While on the other side, for designing a therapy for a pain, yes, the drug should act immediately. Then and then it will survive into the market. If you design a drug which act in a pain, maybe after 2-3 days, is it feasible? No. None of the patient will wait for the anti-pain or analgesis effect for 2-3 days. Correct? So these are very minor aspect but need to be considered based on the knowledge of the clinical pharmacology. In clinical development, the clinical pharmacology supports the design of the clinical studies during the conduct, during the analysis of the clinical trial, as well as for interpretation of the results. Now, why clinical pharmacology studies, or in other words, in process perspective, why clinical trials are carried out, why they are required? Yes, it is obvious, it is required. Although the animal data, it gives a very good information. The excellent information can be generated using a research carried out in animals, in cell lines, in tissues, in vivo, in vitro, the pharmacokinetic, pharmacodynamic efficacy as well as safety. But the animal data are not sufficient so that the drug can be used as a therapeutic agent in a human population. Okay? That animal data create an excellent base for exposing a human for a trial purpose, not for use, not for therapy. Why? Because the animal cannot report, cannot explain certain kind of side effect like headache, blurred vision, joint ache or feeling suicidal. So such effect cannot be identified from animal studies. In addition to that, although some of the animal has a biology similar to human, but in certain aspect it differs from the human. That's why they are animal and we are humans. So there is a difference. And because of that difference, the alone animal data are not sufficient. Sometimes the drug pharmacokinetic, it differs from the animal to human. The example is dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers, almost all calcium channel blockers. They are eliminated extensively by metabolism. The rat shows a very high capacity to metabolize this compound if compared with the human. Okay, so they does not represent the PK data of such drugs cannot be evaluated just by animal studies. Now why? Because there is a very big difference in the enzymes responsible for metabolism of this particular compound. That's why the regulatory bodies, they specifically ask a human clinical trial data, human pharmacokinetic data for a new drug. I will not go deep into this slide. This talks about what are the differences between different animal species and human in terms of distribution of this metabolizing enzymes, liver metabolism enzyme. But yes, because of this difference, regulatory science, regulatory bodies, they ask for a human pharmacokinetic data. Sometimes the animal data shows the drug safe, but it may not be the fact. It may be a toxic. The example is TGN1412. It's a monoclonal antibody. In animal studies, this particular drug, it shows excellent safety. But when its first in human trial was carried out in March 2006, that first in human trial results in a catastrophic life-threatening conditions to volunteers who were enrolled into the trial. And from at the same moment itself, the clinical development program of this particular drug was stopped, although the drug was found absolutely safe during the animal or during the preclinical studies. Another example is this Merck's adenosine A2A receptor antagonist, a Parkinson drug. This drug has been found to produce a very good anti-Parkinson effect in animal model. But when it reached to a phase 3 clinical trial, the phase 3 clinical trial data shows that it is as good as placebo. So there is no clinically significant or statistically significant effect in Parkinson disease. And the sponsor has invested almost 400 million in this particular compound, and they need to stop the further development because of the ineffectiveness of the drug in the target population. Now, these are the cases, the live real examples in which the results of animal studies does not match with the human studies. Hence, it cannot be the case always that if the drug is found safe and efficacious in animal, they are safe and efficacious in human. That's why the phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4 clinical trial data are asked by regulators in order to provide, in order to approve the drug for sale into the market. Now, why this drug fails? Mainly in clinical trial. There are various reasons. The data of 119 drug which has been failed during the clinical development, clinical trial, and the reasons, the results have been compiled by one of the researcher, and it shows that there are three main reasons because of that the drug is failing during the development stage. One of the most important reason is the lack of efficacy, and second most important was the poor pharmacokinetic. And This account for almost 70 to 75% rejection, failure of the compound. And that's why human data is the ultimate data based on which the regulator approves the drugs. Now, we saw the examples in which the drug has been found safe in animal, but later on during clinical trial, it was found toxic to the human. But it can be reverse also. Sometimes the drug is found safe in human, but are toxic to the animal. There are certain examples. The penicillin, well-known drug, it's a toxic to guinea pig. The guinea pig, if it is administered to a guinea pig in an equivalent dose, which is currently being used in human, then it may cause a severe diarrhea, loss of appetite, dehydration. It drops the body temperature and may lead to a death in guinea pigs. The aspirin, the most widely used drug in cardiac patient with coagulopathies or in patient for treatment of a headache. The aspirin, it's a OTC drug for use in human, but it's poisonous to the cat as well as it's very dangerous to the dogs also. The furosemide, the Lasix, most widely used diuretic drug. It is absolutely safe for use in human, but it causes severe liver damage in mice. Okay, sometimes, now not always, that preclinical results or a clinical trial demonstrate the drug's efficacy and safety. There are certain chances that even these clinical trials are also not sufficient. Phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, 4 may not be sufficient. And that's why, even after showing good efficacy and safety in phase 1, phase 2, and as well as phase 3 clinical trial, the drug is launched into the market and then is withdrawn back from the market. The troglitazone, gatifloxazine, rofecoxib, these are the well-known examples which has been, these are the drugs which has been withdrawn from the market, although they have been found safe and efficacious in phase 3 clinical trial. So it's very important, you know, to make sure to keep watch of the drug's efficacy and safety even after market entry. The reason is a science, clinical pharmacology. Clinical pharmacology says that animal data can provide you good, excellent base for a human exposure, and human data provide sufficient evidence to use into the patient. But it does not assure that it is always efficacious or always safe. That's why phase 4 clinical trials are to be carried out even after the drug is approved and enter into the market. And at each and every stage of development, starting from phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4 clinical trial, the data is thoroughly analyzed by the expert clinical pharmacologist to make sure that the development is proceeding in the right direction or not. And especially to make a go or a no-go decision. It is always expected from business perspective that we always make a go decision, okay? We always pass the drug in phase 1, phase 2. But it is also important to make a early no-go decision in order to save time, money and effort. If we by mistake make a go decision, what will happen? The drug will fail in the later stage of the clinical development. Even though in later stage, let's say we make a go decision, then what will happen? The drug will fail after entry into the market. So after investing $1 million or $1 billion in the clinical development, the drug will fail. So it is very important to make a no-go decision early in order to save time, money and efforts. So always avoid a false positive decision and don't miss an early true negative decision. This is very important from the regulatory perspective when the regulators are evaluating a drug for approval for use into the patient population. And that's why the clinical development is carried out step by step, starting with phase one, phase two, phase three, and phase four. And at each and every stage, the data is analyzed, not only by the internal sponsors, clinical pharmacology expert, but also by the regulators to ensure that the progress is in right direction with avoiding a false positive decision and without missing a true negative decision. Now, these are certain terminologies which are very common being used in the clinical development. Pharmacokinetic, ADME, everybody must be well aware. Pharmacodynamic, it's a effect of drug, how the drug produces the effect, the beneficial effect as well as toxic effects. Pharmacometrics is a science which measures the effect of drug, a quantitative estimation of the effect of drug by estimating the level, the intensity or the magnitude of the disease before giving drug and after giving drug, and correlating the intervention, the drug, with the disease, whether the intervention is producing a beneficial effect or not. That kind of analysis. It also involved a concentration effect relationship, dose response relationship studies, PK/PD relationship studies. Now this all is applicable to drug, but what exactly is the drug? From a regulatory perspective, the definition of drug, it includes the article which are recognized by, for example, if the definition of drug is as per the US FDA, then it's an article recognized by the United States Pharmacopoeia, the official homeopathic pharmacopoeia of the United States, or the official national formulary, and that article is intended for use in diagnosis, cure, mitigation, treatment, and prevention of the disease, or it is intended to affect the structure or function of the body, then it is a drug. Now this NCE, this is also very commonly used terminology. As per US FDA, NCE is a drug that contains no active moiety which has been approved by the US FDA previously. So it's a new moiety which is currently proposed to be a drug. Then it is called NCE. The full form is a new chemical entities. An active moiety is a molecule or an ion, okay, excluding the appended portion, the salt form, or that is to be considered excluded. The core moiety, which is responsible for the physiological or pharmacological action, that core moiety is called new chemical entity. New molecular entity is the active ingredient that contains no active moiety which has been previously approved. So it's a new chemical entity containing active ingredient which has not approved by the regulator, that is called new molecular entity. The investigational new drug, IND, it's also very common terminology, and it refers to a request to the US FDA for authorization to administer the drug to human. That request, that process, that application is called investigational new drug application. The request is to administer into the human, not to treat, but for conducting a clinical trial. So IND is the application to US FDA to give a permission to initiate the clinical development. The new drug application is a complete application containing all the data demonstrating the safety as well as efficacy of a new drug in a human in order to request for the approval. So IND is the first application through which the innovator or the pharmaceutical company request the US FDA to start the clinical trial, and NDA is the application of the same drug again, but after completing the clinical trials. That application is to get the approval. Now there are various categories of the NDA, and based on the type of the drug, based on the stage of the development, the NDA application is classified and it is evaluated by the different department, different teams in the US FDA. Now, not all the drugs are chemicals. There are many drugs which are the biological compound. Biological compounds are nothing but a complex structure made up of proteins, amino acids. That kind of compound are called biological compound. They are the product or a substance derived from a living organism and are used for the prevention or the treatment of the disease. That kind of substance are called biological product. And for them, there is a different terminology being used, a biological license application. So this is all about different type of new drug applications, new biological applications. Based on that, different country use a different terminologies, new therapeutic entities, new molecular entities, new biological entities, new chemical entities, and new active substance. Such kind of terminologies are being used by over United States, in European Union. Now what about India? Now in India, it is referred as an API, active pharmaceutical ingredient. It means that any substance which can be used in pharmaceutical formulation with intention to provide a pharmacological activity or otherwise have a direct effect for diagnosis, cure, mitigation, treatment, or prevention of the disease, and to have a direct effect in restoring, correcting, or modifying the physiological functions in human being or animal. This definition is the recently revised Schedule Y. Now it is termed as a new drug and clinical trial rule 2019. The new drugs and clinical trial rule 2019 also defines investigational new drug and the new chemical entities. The investigational new drug is a new chemical or biological entity or substance that has not been approved for marketing as a drug in any country. It's a purely new substance. The new chemical entity means any substance that has not been approved for marketing as a drug by a drug regulatory authority of any country, including the Indian authorities, and it is proposed first time by demonstrating or by establishing the safety and efficacy for use into the humans. And accordingly, based on the new drug application, the definition of new drug in India, it says it is defined as a drug which is not being used in the country for a significant time and has not been approved as a safe or efficacious by the Indian Drug Regulatory Authority. The drug, either it is approved for certain claim, but is proposed to be marketed with some modified form, some new formulation from other or new unapproved, as of today, not approved route of administration, dose and doses form. That application is also, that particular product is also called a new drug. So if somebody formulate a new formulation of already approved molecule, it becomes a new drug as per this definition, because it's a new formulation. It's a modified form, or it's a new claim, or it's a new route, or new dose and dosage. That's why. If it is a The product is a fixed dose combination of a two or more drug which are either approved separately but first time proposed in a combined form. Then also it is a new drug. That product is a new drug. If it is a modified or sustained release form of a already approved molecule or is a novel drug delivery system, then that product is a new drug as per the definition of new drug and clinical trial rule 2019 India. If it is a vaccine or recombinant DNA product or is a living modified organism, monoclonal antibodies, stem cells or any similar kind of product intended for use as a drug, then also it is a, that product is a new drug for Indian regulators. So the new drug and CT rule is based on the product, the final finished form of the product. It defines it as a new drug or not based on its final finished form. The pharmaceutical formulation is also defined in this rule. It means that any preparation which is intended for directly administration to the human, that preparation, that form is called pharmaceutical formulation. The new drug clinical trial rule also defines the clinical trial. The clinical trial is a process or it's a investigation involving the human subject for discovering or verifying its clinical, pharmacological, including pharmacodynamic, pharmacokinetic or adverse effect, with the objective of determining safety and tolerability of such new drug or the investigational new drug. That is, that process is called clinical trial. This, now there are various rules, various suggested designs available in the United States Food and Drug Guideline, and that clinical trial which is to be carried out in such a way that it is acceptable by US FDA, then it should have a control. You must have heard this word, control clinical trial. What do you mean by control? Control is comparing with other than test. So whenever the clinical trial is carried out and you want it to be accepted by regulatory body, your clinical trial should have a control. Your clinical trial should have something treatment other than test. Now, what could be other than test? You need to use either a placebo. Okay, you can use a no treatment arm. So in a group of subject, you doesn't need to provide a test treatment. That is called no treatment arm control. For dose response control trial, you can use a different dose of that particular product and you can compare your test dose with the that controlled dose. And in such scenario, if you want to prove that your test product is superior than the control, then that kind of studies can be considered as a superiority trial. And if your objective is to demonstrate that it is as good as dose response or as good as the reference treatment, then it is called a non-inferiority trial. So if you want to prove that your product is as good as which is available in the market, it is non-inferiority trial. But if you want to prove that it is better than placebo or better than no treatment or better than the active treatment or better than the comparator or already existing treatment, then it is called a superiority trial. Now, why these two designs are considered different? Because in these designs, when the data is analyzed statistically, the statistical method which is being used are different. When we analyze the clinical trial data of non-inferiority trial, we need to demonstrate the equivalence. The test is as good as reference using statistical methods. But when we are analyzing a data of a superiority trial, we doesn't need to demonstrate the equivalence. We need to demonstrate that test is producing a better effect than the reference. So the statistical method which is used in superiority trial are different than the non-inferiority trial. And based on the objective of the clinical trial, this particular control is to be used, and accordingly statistical methods need to be used. Now sometimes when this control is not visible as per the serial number 1 to 4, the historic control can also be used. Historic control is nothing but comparing the already existing data, comparing your clinical trial data with already published data or already existing data. Sometimes a baseline control is also used. Baseline is nothing but comparing the certain biological markers before treatment and after treatment. But it is not the only acceptable way of approving the drug. US FDA always expect a control arm. Baseline comparison is not a sufficient to demonstrate the safety or efficacy. Now, as I said, a microdose study. This microdose studies are carried out specially during a very early stage. Early stage, it means during a drug discovery stage. It used, as the name says, micro level dose, 1/100th of the pharmacologically predicted effective dose. And the purpose is to check the human pharmacokinetic. Now, in previous slide, we discussed that one of the major reason of failure of a new drug is poor pharmacokinetic. So it is better if we identify a drug having a poor pharmacokinetic during a drug discovery stage itself, so we can make a no-go decision as early as possible. For that, this microdose studies are carried out. The new compound is administered into a human after labeling it with some radioactive substance. And its distribution all over the body is estimated with the help of very high sensitive methods, including LC-MS/MS, accelerated mass spectrometry, and PET scan. Because of the radioactivity, it will give a very good, it can be detected in a very micro, in picogram, even nanogram also inside the body, and gives an idea whether the drug reached to the target site or not. Pharmacokinetic, whether the drug has a desirable pharmacokinetic or not. So it gives a early idea that whether drug is reaching to a target tissue, a target location inside the body, so that a desirable pharmacokinetic, a pharmacodynamic can be obtained, desirable therapeutic effect if can be produced in the human or not. Now this is a typical set of instruments which is being used in microdose studies. So this microdose studies, it helps in making a go, no-go early decision at a very early stage. It requires a very minute quantities. There is a minimal risk to the volunteers. Why? Because 1/100th of the pharmacologically effective dose is used. So there is no risk of any toxicities. It is as low as it is exposed during a, you know, traveling through any polluted environment. Okay, so when you travel through any polluted environment, you get exposed to the entire external chemicals, but up to that much extent this new drug is exposed in microdose studies to a human. So it's very safe. It can be an attractive approach for a new drug and for existing drug also, especially for vulnerable populations. Metabolic profiling, drug-drug interaction studies, and identification of a site of action, measuring the drug concentration at the actual site. This all is possible with the help of microdose studies. But it cannot replace the traditional phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 clinical trial. After microdose study, if the results are found promising, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 and phase 4 clinical trial are required. This microdose study involved a radio labeling. So sometimes, getting its approval is very difficult. And the analytical technique of microdose studies are very costly. It requires a very big capital investment. After microdose study, if the compound is found favorable, having a favorable pharmacokinetic, then it undergoes a formulation development. Okay, it undergoes various preclinical development, toxicity studies, and then the results are again analyzed and a decision is made whether to go ahead or not. If it is found suitable to move further, then the next step is a clinical development. So once the formulation is ready, all animal toxicity data are available, not all but sufficient animal toxicity data which create a base which ensures or which supports the regulatory requirement, which fulfills the regulatory requirement so that it can be administered to a human volunteers for clinical trial purpose, then its clinical development starts. The clinical development starts with the phase 1 clinical trial. So this phase 1 clinical trial, they are conducted with the objective to test the safety in the humans. They are also called initial safety studies. This is required by the regulatory bodies. They are conducted among 30 to 100 healthy volunteers, mainly the healthy volunteers. Patient population may be used in phase 1 clinical trial, but only if the drug is not advisable to administer into healthy volunteers. Yes, there are certain chemicals, certain drugs which are toxic to healthy volunteers, like the chemotherapeutic agent, the cytotoxic chemotherapeutic agent. They are not recommended for administration to healthy person. That's why the phase 1 clinical trial of this cytotoxic anti-cancer drugs are carried out in stage 4 or stage 3 cancer patient only. So this phase 1 clinical trial typically start with the first in human clinical trial with the help of maximum recommended starting dose. This maximum recommended starting dose is derived from the animal data. The animal data gives a no observed adverse event label from which the human equivalent dose is derived, and the safety factor is applied, and the pharmacologically active dose is considered while deriving the MRSD, maximum recommended starting dose. There is a very detailed guideline. If given a chance, I can very well present on this particular topic also, that how to derive a human dose from animal for first in human clinical trial. And yes, this is the role of clinical pharmacologist. And here comes the role of clinical pharmacology. The interpretation of preclinical data and making a decision whether to go or not, and how to go, at what dose to administer the phase 1 clinical trial subject, the starting dose. The objective of this phase 1 clinical trial program is to establish the upper limit. It is called a maximum tolerated dose, and to study the adverse effect, pharmacokinetic, and if possible, then the pharmacodynamic also. But the primary objective is to establish the maximum tolerated dose, a dose beyond which, the dose higher than that, if administered, it may cause certain toxicities which can put the volunteer at an unacceptable risk. So maximum tolerated dose is an upper limit which should not be exceeded in phase 1 as well as phase 2, phase 3 as well as phase 4 clinical trial, as well as during the use in the market. So the one of the most important objective of phase 1 clinical trial is to establish this maximum tolerated dose. There are certain considerations when we design a phase 1 clinical trial. The risk associated need to be checked based on the mechanism of action, based on preclinical data. If there is any potential or immediate long-term toxicity, if any observed during non-clinical or during animal studies, that need to be thoroughly analyzed. The presence of any biomarker need to be identified, which help us to monitor the healthy volunteers for detecting the toxic effect. And the criteria for safety analysis and dose escalation decision need to be considered when the phase 1 clinical trial is designed. Now there are certain scenarios in which this phase 1 clinical trial requires a special attention. So when the application is made to regulator to conduct a phase 1 clinical trial, the regulator also considered this point, and based on this point they provide the recommendation to modify the design or may approve the clinical trial or may reject the application for conducting this phase 1 clinical trial. That the special consideration is required when the new drug has a novel or a not currently well characterized mechanism of action. So if the drug is acting through some new biological pathway or new molecular pathway, then yes, the phase 1 clinical trial requires a special attention, because the manipulation of that particular biological pathway may produce certain effect which have never been studied in human yet. It's a novel mechanism. That's why it requires special attention. If the new drug is acting directly or indirectly involving an immune system, then it requires a special attention. If the new drug has a mode of action involving a target that is connected to multiple signaling pathway, okay? So if the drug is acting through multiple signaling pathway, then yes, the phase 1 clinical trial requires a special attention. If there is any novelty in the structure, almost 80-90% structure is new, then phase 1 clinical trial requires special attention. If a species-specific mechanism exists, it means that in animal the drug acts through some different pharmacological mechanism, and in human it may act through some different mechanism, then yes, the phase 1 clinical trial requires a special attention. If there is a possibility of non-monitorable or irreversible toxicities, then phase 1 clinical trial requires a special attention. And if there is a possibility of non-linear pharmacokinetic, then also requires special attention. Now, why this scenario requires a special attention? Because this scenario increases the probability of risk when this phase 1, first in human phase 1 clinical trial is carried out into the human. Okay, because we cannot take or we cannot risk the healthy volunteers for the sake of our research. Okay, that's why this phase 1 clinical trial are carried out in special facilities. That facilities are now approved by the regulators. The regulator inspect the phase 1 clinical trial unit, they approve it, and then this approved phase 1 clinical trial is carried out in approved phase 1 clinical trial facility only. They are conducted by trained staff involving the medical doctors, nurses, emergency experts in a special centers, This phase one clinical trial can be crossover parallel designs. Placebos are also used. They are also randomized and the blinding is also involved. And there is a chance that the drug may pass in phase one clinical trial. The probability is a 50%. For high risk product, this first in human clinical trial is carried out by exposing only one volunteer at a time. So only first subject is dosed and is observed for at least 24 to 48 hours depending on the pharmacokinetic of the drug, and then the second, third and fourth subject is exposed. If the product is to be administered intravenously in phase one clinical trial, then in first in human trial, this product is injected at very slow infusion rate, okay, over a several hour, rather than injecting directly within 30 minutes or within 10 minutes. The healthy subjects are mainly used in phase one trial, and the subject which are used in phase, who are enrolled in this phase one clinical trial should have enough capacity, enough sense or a judgment for complaining any unusual effect. Foolish, stupid, insincere and non-cooperative subjects are excluded from phase one clinical trial. They start with the maximum recommended dose in very few subjects, one or three subjects, and the dose is slowly increased to a next group of subject, and that increment in dose continue till some toxic effect is observed. And once it is observed, and if it meets to the definition of maximum tolerated dose, then escalation, dose escalation is stopped at that point, and that particular dose is declared as a maximum tolerated dose. So there are certain rules, certain scientific definitions of maximum tolerated dose, dose limiting toxicities, and based on that decision is made whether to increase the dose or not. Now there are certain studies, you know, a special phase one clinical trial with some special objective. Why? Because this phase one clinical trial is not just a single clinical trial, it's a set of different clinical trials, maybe 10 to 15 clinical trials, a group of different studies. One of them is called a thorough QT, QTC studies also. In the certain regulatory bodies, this phase, this thorough QT, QTC studies also termed as a phase 3 trial, because it is usually carried out once phase 2 clinical trial data is available. So that's why not necessary that phase 1 clinical trial, it means that it has to be completed, then and then phase 2 can be carried out. No. Certain sets of phase 1 clinical trial, if completed, then phase 2 clinical trial can be started. And once some of the data is generated from phase 2 clinical trial, based on that, the remaining phase 1 clinical trials are started. So there is a zigzag way of, you know, conducting a clinical trial. Some of the phase 1, then phase 2, then phase 2A, phase 2B, then some of the phase 1, then some of the again phase 1, then phase 3A, then again phase 1, then some of the phase 3B. Okay, so this is one of the example that thorough QT, QTC studies, they are mainly conducted once some idea of therapeutic dose is obtained from phase 2 or phase 3 clinical trial. This particular specialized phase 1 trial is carried out to check the effect of drug on a QT interval of the electrocardiogram. Now why? Because this QT interval, it represents the ventricular events, and if this QT interval is prolonged, it increases the risk of ventricular tachyarrhythmias. It is called torsades de pointis. It's very fatal cardiac arrhythmia which can lead to a death immediately. And there is a special guideline in US FDA that how to carry it out phase this kind of thorough QT-QTC studies. Even ICH also has a special guideline for design, conduct, analysis and interpretation of this thorough QT-QTC studies. These are very sensitive studies, phase 1 trial, thorough QT-QTC trial. They are conducted at the effective dose which has been identified in phase 1, 2 or phase 3 studies. They are single or multiple dose study. They are conducted at anticipated therapeutic dose and a supra-therapeutic dose. Supra-therapeutic dose is nothing but a double or 3 or 4 times higher than the therapeutic dose. The thorough QT-QTC study also use a placebo. It uses a certain formula to correct the QT interval. And the ECG is analyzed with a special software system and the QT interval is measured with the digital calipers because it's very sensitive method. The ECG undergoes a typical 3-level analysis and various calculations are done in order to calculate change in QT interval from baseline and in comparison with the placebo, and that is interpreted with the help of the well-defined criteria. And if it exceeds a 10 millisecond, the prolongation is more than 10 millisecond, mean effect should not be more than 5 millisecond, and the statistically derived one side confidence interval should not exceed 10 millisecond, then this particular compound can be considered non-QT prolonging. But if it is found that the drug is prolonging the QT interval, then either the drug applicant need to justify that why the drug can be approved, or if the regulator approve the drug, then a special notice will appear into a prescribing information that this drug prolongs the QT interval, so the patient's ECG is to be monitored by a physician. Okay, so such certain precautions need to be added. The drug is prolonging the QT interval. You must have observed such kind of label in the prescribing information leaflet for certain drugs, that this drug prolongs the QT interval, so the physician should check the ECG before prescribing this drug, or the physician should monitor the post-treatment ECGs, post-therapy ECGs at regular interval, something like that. Okay, so this is just one example. There are many different type of specialized phase 1 trial which are carried out during the clinical development. It includes a PK or ADME studies, PK/PD studies, mass balance studies, bioavailability, bioequivalence studies, food effect studies, gender effect studies. In short, any study which is carried out with an objective to evaluate safety, tolerability or pharmacokinetic, then it belongs to a phase 1 clinical trial. But if it is carried out with an objective to evaluate efficacy of the drug, then it belongs to phase 2 or phase 3 clinical trial. Now, this all studies have a specific objective, and that objective is to generate data in order to fulfill the regulatory requirement. Okay, so if you see any new drug application guideline of US FDA or the India's new city rule, to fulfill that requirement, to generate that data, this particular set of clinical trials are carried out. So this is all about our part one. Let us have a 5 or 10 minute break. Then we'll continue the part two. In part two, we will discuss a practical scenario. I will give you the real examples of new drugs, new chemicals, and how that particular new drug or that particular chemical has undergone various phase 1, phase 2, phase 1, phase 3 trial and has reached to the market. And why they have been undergone certain set of clinical trial and how this go or no-go decision is made by the clinical pharmacologist as well as by the regulators. Okay, so let's have a 10 to 15 minute break and we'll come back. It's 15:05. We'll come back by 15:15, correct?
Okay, thank you very much, sir. As sir said, we will continue by 15:15,
yes. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so let us start the part two. Hope everybody has joined back.
Yes, sir, all are online only, Zoom meeting.
Okay, so after this phase one clinical trial, I have just given you a background with clinical pharmacology perspective in regulatory decision making, as well as the scientific decision making, I would say. Then, after this phase one clinical trial, the next phase is a phase two. Now, the phase one is a set of certain clinical trials which are carried out to address, to check the safety, tolerability, and pharmacokinetic. Now, once we have a certain idea, not the complete, but sufficient idea of safety, pharmacokinetic, and tolerability, we can very well test a new drug into a patient population. Why? Because we have certain idea of the safety, tolerability, and pharmacokinetic. These are sufficient to test the drug in patients. That's why the phase two clinical trial are conducted in patients. The purpose of conducting this phase two clinical trial is to again check the safety in patient as well as the efficacy in a more specific set of patient. Now, in patient, when I say the phase two trial are conducted in patient, but in which kind of patient? Diabetic, let's say, for example, for anti-diabetic drug. Mild diabetic patient, moderate or very severe diabetic patient. So in a particular disease population also, there are subset. There are a special, more criteria specific population. Okay, so phase two clinical trial is carried out in a possible target population. Why I had used the word possible? Because we don't know that whether, for example, anti-diabetic drug, this drug will work in mild diabetic, moderate diabetic, or will also work in severe diabetes. Okay, so we don't know. It's a possible target population. It's not a confirmed target population. The objective of conducting phase two trial is to study the pharmacodynamic, the adverse effect, and the drug interactions with the drugs which the patient is already taking. The pharmacokinetic in patients. Now in phase two, the pharmacokinetic is also studied. Now it is not like that in phase one, we have established the pharmacokinetic. Now we know in phase one, from phase one clinical trial result, that this is the Cmax, this is the Tmax, this is the area under the curve, this is the half-life. No. Although we need to verify that, is it same in patient or not? Because sometimes the pharmacokinetic of drug may differ from healthy volunteer to patient. So the results of pharmacokinetic of phase one clinical trial may differ from the phase two clinical trial when phase two is conducted in patient and phase one is in healthy volunteers. Okay. The phase two clinical trial, they are also called therapeutic exploratory studies or therapeutic pilot studies. Why exploratory and why pilot? Because they are the early stage clinical trial in a patient population. We are just exploring the beneficial effect into the patient. Okay, we are not confirming because we don't know. First, we need to know that what are the beneficial effect in patient, and then we will confirm it whether it is really happening or not. So phase two is called therapeutic exploratory studies or a therapeutic pilot studies. They are also called proof of concept studies or a first in patient study. First in patient is self understood, but why proof of concept? Because here is the concept, here is the chance where we will demonstrate our drug's effect. Okay, if somebody has designed an anti-diabetic molecule, then at this stage, the chance will be given. The molecule will get a chance to demonstrate the anti-diabetic effect in patient. That's why these studies are called proof of concept studies. And is a first in patient studies. The objective of phase 2 trial is to identify the optimum dose and dosage in a particular clinical condition. That at what dose or at what dose range and at what dosage, once in a day, twice in a day, thrice in a day, that is called dosage, or every day. That information need to be generated and in a particular clinical condition. This phase 2 trials are relatively short period studies. Okay, let's say for example in diabetic patient, if we want to do a phase 2 clinical trial in diabetic patient, then phase 2 clinical trial is typically for at least 1 week, or maybe 1 to 2 week, maybe up to 3 week, depending on the pharmacological class of the drug. Now it is obvious that within 1 or 2 or 3 week, the good control, the control over the blood sugar level in terms of HbA1c, the effect of on HbA1c cannot be demonstrated, because to produce a significant effect of HbA1c in diabetes, it requires at least a 2 or 3 months treatment. But if in phase 2 trial, if we demonstrate that the drug is controlling the morning fasting sugar level and the postprandial sugar level over a period of 1, 2, or over a period of 3 weeks without any or with an acceptable side effect, then there is a chance that if the same treatment is continued over a 2 or 3 months, it will definitely produce a desired control over HbA1c. Okay, so the phase 2 is relatively shorter duration studies if compared with phase 3. They may be divided into two parts. The phase 2a, they are typically called dose ranging study, in which a certain broader range of dose are used and check whether at which optimum dose there is a desired pharmacodynamic or desired therapeutic effect. And beyond that dose, there is no additional advantage. There are certain drugs, not certain, but almost all drugs, they have certain limitations that beyond a certain dose, the drug stop producing the addition in therapeutic effect. So if there is no added advantage by increasing the dose, there is no need to increase the dose. Okay. So that we need to check in this dose ranging study, that up to what extent the increase in dose is giving an increase in therapeutic effect. And then phase 2b study are called definitive dose response study, in which they are typically two pivotal studies which are initiated at effective dose and dosage and are checked in a small set of patients. This phase 2 studies are usually conducted in 50 to 300 patients and conducted in various sites, hospitals or clinics. And they are repeated with change in dose or in more specific subgroup to identify the best target population and to identify the best dose and dosage. They are carried out by specialized setup or clinic or hospitals, and this require expert specialized doctors, investigators. They are usually single-centric, but not always single-centric. Most of the phase 2 trials are carried out in 2 or 3 centers. They are usually parallel design, also crossover. Placebos are sometimes used and active comparator treatment is also used. Randomization and blinding is also used. The marker of disease are used instead of directly measuring the outcome of the disease. Okay, as I said, in diabetes, the outcome of the disease is measured in terms of effect on HbA1c. Okay, but in phase 2, in anti-diabetic drug, the marker of disease is measured. That I say morning fasting sugar and postprandial sugar level. The pharmacodynamic tool or pharmacometric methods are used to, you know, study the dose-response relationship, pharmacokinetic, pharmacodynamic studies. The variability in the therapeutic effect is studied. This is very important objective of phase 2 clinical trial. And the possibility of dropout, incomplete or loss of data is also studied in phase 2 clinical trial. Now, this two particular point, the variability and possibility of dropout, this two point gives a great support when the phase 3 trial is designed. So this is a backbone of phase 3 clinical trial. This information which is coming out from phase 2 provides a very important support for phase 3. And if this particular information is accurately generated in phase 2, then the phase 3 can be similar with, it can be with a similar outcome like a phase 2. So the in entire clinical development process, from business perspective, the phase 2 clinical trial are considered the most important clinical trial. Why? Because if phase 2 clinical trial are conducted accurately, it saves a lot of time, money and effort. But if there is a quality issue in phase 2 clinical trial, if the phase 2 clinical trial is not conducted seriously, sensitively, and there are error in the data, then there will be a definitely going to be a problem in phase 3 trial, and some surprising result will be observed in phase 3 trial. So the success of the phase 3 trial is mainly depend on the phase 2 trial, and the phase 3 trial are the costliest part of drug development. Almost 30% budget of the entire drug development is consumed by the phase 3 trial only. The reason why, because phase 3 trial are multicentric, multi-country, very large in terms of number of patient enrollment, and it involves lots of cost. So whenever we are going to do a very budget consuming activity, and if that particular activity is based on certain set of information, as I said, the information, the results of phase 2, and if that information is not accurate, then the chances are that budget consuming activity, phase 3 trial, it will give a surprising results. Okay, so from business perspective, this phase 2 trials are very important. The results of phase 3 studies greatly associated with the phase 3 studies, and it is observed by expert that the failure of drug in phase 3 is sometimes associated with improper strategy of phase 2 study only. So this phase 2 studies are very tricky study. It can be a turning point for a drug, and the rejection ratio is very high in phase 2 trial, and the design perfection accuracy of phase 2 trial can save lots of time and money, and it also decides a future of the drug development accordingly. And the purpose of conducting this phase 2 study is to determine a few drug dose and dosage. Okay. In phase 2 trial, we just need to come up with the information of a drug that at X dose for so many days, if it is given in X kind of patient, it will give desirable therapeutic effect. That's all. Now that same thing we need to prove in phase 3, but it should be accurate. Okay, so the purpose of this phase two trial is to create a strong base for phase three. And the phase three, as I said, they are very costly. They are called a therapeutic confirmatory trial. They are also called definitive efficacy trial. Now, why confirmatory? Because we are just confirming what we had observed in phase two, but in larger population, let's say up to 3,000, in large and diverse population. This phase three clinical trial are carried out in all the geography in which the pharmaceutical company want to sell the product. Okay, so if the pharmaceutical company want to sell the product in India, in US, and Europe, then phase two clinical trial need to be carried out in India, Europe, and US, multi-country, or three phase three clinical trial in each and every country. They are compared. They use a new treatment versus a standard treatment or which are already available in the market, or sometimes a placebo. Now, use of placebo is, you know, requires a certain ethical consideration. If ethically it is correct, then only it is allowed, otherwise not. And the objective of phase three clinical trial is to prove the safety and efficacy in a proposed clinical indication, in a proposed geographic region, or in that particular population. They can be randomized, blinded, parallel, crossover. They are carried out at hospital sites, requires a practicing doctors as an investigator. They are very long-term trial, okay, long if compared with the phase two. And the disease outcome or very long-term outcome are measured. The clinical endpoints are measured and pharmacodynamic tool or pharmacometric methods are used so that a successful NDA application can be filed and approval can be obtained. They are very complex studies. Lots of challenges are involved, not only in design conduct, but also in analysis interpretation. There is a lots of logistic involved. That's why they are very costly. And to conduct a phase three clinical trial, to initiate a phase three clinical trial itself is an achievement for that particular drug. So you must have observed in news that pharmaceutical companies, they announce that their new chemical entity has reached phase three trial. So reaching a phase three trial is itself is an achievement. And why they announce? Because, you know, it's achievement. It's a celebration time. And if it succeeds in phase three, then it's a addition to that achievement. Sometimes the branding of phase 3 trial is also carried out. You must have observed a trade name. They register, the pharmaceutical company sometimes register the name, the acronym of the phase 3 as a trademark. Okay. The interim analyses are carried out in phase 3 trial. And the new designs like adaptive designs are also used in phase 3 clinical trial. And based on the quality of phase 2, the rejection probability is 30%. And then the drug enter into the market. And after entering into the market, the drug efficacy in the patient population is monitored. That is called phase 4 clinical trial. Now we'll quickly go through the practical. Now here, you can ask if anybody has any questions. They can raise their thumb in the Zoom. You can ask me a question into a chat box. We'll go through one example of clinical development of a new drug. The example is the ABC Pharmaceutical has discovered a new chemical entity, and that new chemical entity has a pharmacological action of interfering the activity of viral RNA dependent RNA polymerase, and it has been shown to cause decrease in viral RNA production in a host cell. Okay, so during a drug discovery, they carried out certain cell-based assay, and they found that one chemical is producing this kind of antiviral effect. And that particular chemical, that particular product is, let's say, product X. Then, because it is producing some antiviral effect, they carried out preclinical studies. So they carried out many preclinical studies with using that product X to study its pharmacokinetic, pharmacological effect, as well as toxicities. And all these preclinical studies shows that the product X, the new chemical entities, is feasible to develop as a oral as well as a parenteral formulation. So from production point of view, from stability into the formulation, its oral tablet or capsule can be developed, as well as its injection can also be developed for product X. Now, as a clinical pharmacologist, this case comes to you. So your first question should be, what could be the best possible target indication for this product X? So what we need to do, we need to look into the mechanism of action of that particular product, that NC. Now here you can see that it produces viral dependent, RNA dependent RNA polymerase, and it shows decrease in viral RNA production into the host cell. So it has an antiviral property. Okay. Now in this COVID-19 pandemic, the most possible choice for target population for such an antiviral product will be COVID-19 or flu. Okay. So as a clinical pharmacologist, we, based on the mechanism, not based on any data, but based on the mechanism of action of that particular NC, we will propose that yes, this product can be developed for COVID-19 or for flu indication, for systemic viral infection, because this drug has an antiviral mechanism of action. Okay, so our target is clear. We want to develop this product X for systemic viral infection, to treat a patient with systemic viral infection. So now second question will be the regulator. The regulator will ask that your product is has an antiviral mechanism and you want to develop it for COVID-19. So even though COVID-19 is a pandemic, the product X cannot be directly allowed to use into COVID-19 patient. Yes, obviously. So what to do so that regulatory body gives a permission to use this antiviral product X for COVID-19 treatment? Just a layman question. What to do? We have to demonstrate. How to demonstrate? By carrying a clinical trial in COVID-19 patients. So the answer is, we need to demonstrate, we need to establish the safety of product X in COVID-19 as well as the efficacy of this product X in COVID-19 treatment. If we demonstrate these two things in clinical trial, then regulatory body will approve our product for sell for use in COVID-19 patients treatment. So the third question to a clinical development team, clinical pharmacology team, will be how to establish this, how to demonstrate a safety in COVID-19 patient, and how to demonstrate efficacy in COVID-19 patient. By conducting a clinical trial in COVID-19 patient, okay. Now, directly conducting clinical trial in COVID-19 patient, would it be feasible? Or let's say the ethics committee or regulatory body will allow you to directly conduct the clinical trial in COVID-19 patient? No. It is okay to directly do clinical trial in COVID-19 patient, The answer is no. Why? Because we cannot take a risk with any COVID-19 patient for clinical trial. Okay? Because the product has never been administered to human yet. Only we have a preclinical data. We don't have any data of human exposure of product X. How much level in blood is achieved after oral administration is not known. So we don't know that what is the absorption, how much percentage of drug is absorbed from the intestine when it is administered in a tablet form or in a capsule form, and how much dose and duration of the treatment is required for product X in COVID-19 to produce a desirable effect so that the patient come out of COVID-19 infection. So this information doesn't exist. This set of information is required. Then and then the regulator or the ethics committee will allow us to do a clinical trial in COVID-19 patient. Okay, so first thing, what we need to do? We need to generate a data of product X for a human administration. We need to generate a data of oral formulation demonstrating its pharmacokinetic, that how much percentage is absorbed, at what dose, what is the blood level inside after absorption in a human volunteers, so that it is proved that the drug is reaching the systemic circulation. Okay. Now, why it is required to demonstrate this kind of pharmacokinetic? Then and then the drug will able to produce the antiviral effect. If drug is not getting absorbed into the intestine, then there is no point in, you know, administering to COVID-19 patient, because the purpose is to treat a systemic viral infection patient. Systemic means inside the blood, inside the body's tissue. So for that, the drug has to reach to a systemic circulation. So if drug is not absorbed, then there is no point of using in COVID-19 patient. So we need to demonstrate that after oral administration, drug is reaching the systemic circulation. And we also need to demonstrate that at what dose, up to what days, if it is administered in COVID-19 patient, it gives a desirable or a good antiviral effect. So the next question will be, what information of product X are required so that clinical trial in COVID-19 patient can be carried out, or the ethics committee or regulator will allow us to do that? The protocol designer, the investigator, and COVID-19 treating physician. Okay, when you will come up with all this information and you will design a protocol for COVID-19 clinical trial, the protocol designer, the doctor who is treating the COVID-19 patient at COVID-19 care or at certain hospital, they will ask you, because they are going to use your product in clinical trial. So they will ask certain question. What they will ask? The first question they will ask, that what is the dose of your test product for clinical trial? What is the dosage, whether it is to be administered once in a day, twice in a day, thrice in a day for COVID-19 patient? What is the duration of treatment? Okay, whether the patient require 1 week treatment, 2 week treatment. So these are the questions they will ask. How safe it is if this oral tablet or oral capsule is given to the patient? Would it be okay for the patient? Whether it will not cause any diarrhea, any vomiting, any irritation to a gastric stomach? Whether it is to be administered with food, without food? All these questions will be asked by COVID-19 treating doctor when you will approach them with your product to carry out trial in their patient. They will also ask that what are the side effects, or what is the nature of side effect if it is administered to COVID-19 patient. Okay, so when this informations are available, then somebody from COVID-19 care centers, some doctor will accept your proposal and will agree to participate in your clinical trial as a site. Otherwise, they will not. Now, how to develop? How, from where this information will come? Any idea that this dose or dosage of product X will work into COVID-19 patient? Yes, this is a very important question they will ask. They will definitely ask that, do you have any idea that your test product will work in my COVID-19 patient? So you should have the answers of these questions. Then and then that particular doctor, that particular hospital will participate in your clinical trial. Now, and this all, the answer of these questions will come from phase 1 and phase 2 clinical trial. The dose, dosage, duration of a treatment we can try in COVID-19 patient, it will come from the phase 2 clinical trial results of product X. How safe this drug and how safe it is in COVID-19 patient, that information will come from phase 1 trial as well as phase 2 trial. What are the side effects and what is the nature of side effect? It again, it will come from phase 1 and phase 2 clinical trial. And whether this will, this product will work in COVID-19 or not, some idea, not assurance, but some idea, that will come from the results of phase 2 clinical trial. So thus, first, all this information need to be generated by conducting phase 1 and phase 2 clinical trial using a product X. Now, how to generate this information? Dose, dosage, duration of treatment from phase 2. Now, to generate this information, we need to carry out several phase 2 trials, because we don't know that at what dose it will produce a desired effect in COVID-19 patient. So we need to try a several different dose, low, medium, high, maybe 5-10 dose, okay? From where we will able to generate that the drug is safe to do phase 2 trial in COVID-19 patient? Now again, over here, to generate this information, we need to carry out a phase 2 trial in COVID-19 patient. So again, to allow to conduct phase 2 trial in COVID-19 patient, the first question will come, that is it safe to carry out phase 2 clinical trial in COVID-19 patient? No, because there is no data exist. To carry out even a small phase 2 trial in COVID-19 patient, phase 1 clinical trial data will be required. What kind of data will be required? Yes, what could be the side effect and what is the maximum tolerated dose? Okay, so to conduct a phase 2 trial, you should have a knowledge of up to what dose product X is tolerable. And during up to that level, what are the minor side effects? Some gastric upset, maybe mild diarrhea, some vomiting sensation, okay? Whatever it is, that idea should be there. Then and then, the phase 2 clinical trial in COVID-19 patient will be allowed it. Now, how to study this side effect and how to establish this maximum tolerated dose that we discussed earlier? By conducting a phase 1 clinical trial. Okay? So, the starting with a reasonably safe dose, we will first conduct a first-in-human phase 1 trial. Slowly, we'll increase the dose. With that, we will study the side effect. We will keep on increasing the dose till it is tolerable to a clinical trial subject. We will use a healthy volunteers for this phase 1 trial. And with that, we also need to study that increasing in oral dose increases the blood level accordingly or not. Now, this is very important. Why? Because if increasing in the oral dose is increasing the level into the blood proportionally, then it is advisable to increase the dose. But sometimes, because of the saturated absorption level, certain drug have a saturation level. Beyond that, if you increase the oral dose, the blood level increment, the increase in blood level is not proportionally good, or sometimes it does not increases the blood level. So it is very important to study a dose proportionality and to identify that whether the drug is increasing the concentration into the blood with increasing our dose or not. This information we need to generate during this clinical trial. Just a moment. Nilay Solanki has asked a question. How to access or evaluate a specific drug interaction with product X in COVID-19 patients? Yes, I will. We will discuss that point. I am coming to this particular question in the next slide, in upcoming slide. Okay. So during phase one clinical trial, we will establish the upper limit and we'll also check whether increasing dose is increases the concentration into the blood or not. Now, in what kind of human population will do? As I said, in healthy volunteer. Why? Because directly exposing a COVID-19 patient for generating pharmacokinetic information or to study this side effect is not advisable. Why? Because COVID-19 patients are already in fear, already in bad conditions, and we cannot do an experiment with COVID-19 patient directly. So product X should likely to have a minimal side effect or no toxic effect if it is administered in human, and it should have no minimal effect on body's vital parameter, blood pressure, heart rate, respiratory rate, ECG, because its pharmacological mechanism of action is only antiviral effect. Okay, that we already have based on preclinical data. Its mechanism of action is already identified. Okay. So based on the preclinical data as well as some of the microdose studies, we know that the drug has a minimal or no toxic effect if it is administered to a healthy human, and it has no impact, no direct effect on vital parameters like blood pressure, heart rate, respiratory rate, ECG, because it has not been observed in animal. That's why we will start with phase one. Now in phase one, there is a big sets of study, as I said, 10 to 15 different type of study. We will start with first in human phase one trial. This will give us idea that further human exposure is safe or not. Then after first in human exposure, we will increase the dose. So that increasing a single dose is called a single ascending dose phase one trial. So this will give us an idea of a single dose maximum tolerated dose, single dose MTD. It is called single dose MTD. So if the drug is administered as a single dose in human, up to what dose it is tolerable, that information we will able to generate from this SAD study. And we will also study the pharmacokinetic, that increase in dose slowly increases the blood level accordingly or not. Now once it is found tolerable in single dose, we will carry out a multiple ascending dose study. So first in human study, then single ascending dose, then multiple ascending dose. In multiple ascending dose, we will administer a drug multiple times, maybe 3 times a day, 2 times a day, once in a day, or all these different permutation combination over a period of 1 week, maybe over a 2 week, and we'll check whether the multiple dose
over a 1 week, 2 week is found tolerable or not, and what is the upper limit. And we'll also study the pharmacokinetic. And with all this information, when all these informations are available, we will further study all this information. With that, we will also deep dive into the preclinical results, the animal studies data, and we'll come up with some range of dose and dosage which we can try in COVID-19 patient in phase 2. Okay, so first in human single and multiple ascending dose studies, this will give us the idea that what is the upper limit, beyond that it can be toxic, and from that, the upper limit, we will come up with two or three lower dose which we will try in COVID-19 patient, and we will inform the COVID-19 doctor that yes, now we have some information that beyond this dose, if it is administered, it can be toxic, but below this dose we can try in COVID-19 patient, and we can check whether it is helpful to COVID-19 patient or not. Now, how long to try? No, we will not try how long, not like a typical phase 3, but we'll try 3 or 5 different doses in COVID-19 patient. So we will carry out a phase 2 trial in COVID-19 patient with X1 dose, dosage and duration. X1 is, let's say for example, once in a day for 14 days. Then we will carry out the another phase 2 trial with X2 dose, dosage duration X2, maybe twice in a day for 14 days. Then X3, dose duration, a slightly higher dose, once in a day for 14 days. X4 can be that slightly higher dose, twice in a day for 14 days. And X5, it can be 3 times in a day for 14 days. And all this in COVID-19 patient in small number, not in large number, in 5 to 10 COVID-19 patient. And we'll check whether after 14 days or maybe after 7 days, what is the condition of patient and what is the RT-PCR results. Okay. And all these results will give us the idea that whether X1 is better, X2 is better, X3 is better, X4 is better, or X5 is better. Okay, how quick is X1? Sometimes it may happen that X3 is a high dose, but once in a day, and X5 is the same high dose, but twice in a day, and X3 and X5 both are treating the COVID-19 patient at a similar speed. Then it is better to use X3 instead of X5. So all this information will give us, you know, to come out with some idea that which particular dose and dosage is optimum for the treatment of COVID-19 patient. Optimum, it means with lesser exposure, quicker effect. Why lesser exposure? Because these are the chemicals. It is better if we expose the COVID-19 patient less, and we get the desired effect. Okay. And after identifying this particular 2 or 3 sets of dose and dosage, we will carry out a large phase 3 trial in COVID-19 patient throughout the country, involving thousands of patients. And we'll generate a data that whether X3 is working better or X5 is working better. Now here in phase 3, we cannot try X1, X2, X3, X4, X5. Why? Because it is very costly, first of all. Second is, if X1 is not working, which we already know in phase 2, then why to try in phase 3? Okay, if X2 is working, but X2 is a twice in a day, and because it is a twice in a day, during evening time, when the patient is on oxygen or some other way, on other aspect, it is difficult to dose, then why to try X2? If it is producing a similar effect like X3, which is a once in a day. So there will be certain scenario we will evaluate that which is most convenient to the patient, most beneficial to the patient, with lesser exposure, with more comfort. Okay, that we will select out of this X1, X2, X3, X4 and X5 and will carry out the larger phase 3 trial and across the country, across the geography, and will prove that this X3 is working or maybe X5 is working. Will generate the data, and with that data will create a complete report, will file the application and will seek for the approval in COVID-19 patient. Now during this phase 2 and phase 3 trial, the patient will be already on different other treatment. So that will also give us an idea. We will compile the adverse effects. We will study the association of a particular set of adverse effects with the concomitant medications, other treatment the patient is receiving during COVID-19, and will come up, is there any drug interaction or not? We will also carry out a drug interaction studies. If there is any trigger, if there is any information which gives us an idea that there is a possibility of drug interaction. So apart from safety and tolerability, the continuous drug interaction verification, checking, and the study of drug interaction will continue in all this trial involving a patient. There are certain guidelines. If the drug is metabolized through certain cytochrome enzymes, then there is a special drug-drug interaction studies we can carry out if the test drug belongs to that particular category. And with all this information, we'll come up with the complete set of application which we will submit to the regulator, and regulator will evaluate it, will give us a chance to do a complete presentation, and will try to make agreed that yes, our treatment is recommended for treatment of COVID-19 patient. So this is the way how a particular drug is developed. So in simple words, the clinical pharmacology is a science which is nothing but understanding the customer or patient therapeutic requirement and checking whether our drug is meeting it that requirement or not. Just as simple as it is. Okay. So I hope, Nila, I had covered your answer. For conducting a drug-drug interaction studies, the information of how the drug is metabolizing into a human, which enzymes are responsible for the metabolism, that information is required. And based on that, whether the drug-drug interaction study is required or not is decided. And if it is required, then it is to be conducted, and the data need to be submitted. Okay, so this is how the clinical pharmacology helps in drug development, not only at a sponsor or investigator or scientist end, but also at a regulator end. In regulatory bodies like US FDA, they have a special department, clinical pharmacology science department. At our Indian regulatory body, they have a subject expert committees involving a various scientists, including a practicing doctor, specialist, clinical pharmacologist, basic scientist, who evaluate the application, as I said, from that angle, and gives the opinion whether the drug is suitable for approval or not. Jalpa has another question. how drug safety reporting is carried out in phase studies. All the clinical trial related adverse events are captured in adverse event form. They are compiled into a final clinical study report, as well as there is a special department in each and every pharmaceutical company called pharmacovigilance department. The adverse events which are occurring in clinical trial are reported to pharmacovigilance department, and that pharmacovigilance department reports all the informations to a regulatory body on a regular basis as per the rules applicable to different countries for pharmacovigilance reporting. I hope I had answered your queries, and wish you all the best, good luck, and the best health in COVID-19 pandemic. If anybody has any more questions, you please feel free to ask. Yes, one more question has arrived. How much time period any company required clinical trial if they launch drug as a generic drug? Now, for generic drug, there is no need to carry out phase 2 or phase 3 trial. The definition of generic drug is, it is using a same route of administration, same for type of formulation and same dose or same strength. For generic drug, only pharmacokinetic comparison is required. Bioequivalence is to be established, and if the test generic drug, it has a comparable pharmacokinetic like a reference product which is already into the market, then that test generic drug will directly get the approval without phase 2 or phase 3 trial. But if there is a change in release pattern or change in pharmacokinetic, then depending on the degree of change, the clinical pharmacologist will evaluate what kind of phase 2, phase 3 clinical trial will be required. Okay.
Sir, one question in the chat session from our one of the student. Is the vaccine development for COVID-19 different from other drug development process?
Yes, it differs a lot. Why? Because in vaccine, pharmacokinetic is not something which is essential, because when we administer a vaccine, so first of all, vaccine is not something like a chemical. So its elimination and its distribution into the body, it is not like a typical drug. There is no need to check its GIT absorption or anything. Most of the vaccines are injectable. But in vaccine, the immune response is to be measured. And the immune response is measured in terms of the antibody level achieved after vaccination. So before administration of vaccine, the subject's antibody level is checked. It should be below certain limit. If it is not below certain limit, then that subject doesn't fit to the enrollment criteria of the trial. Now, why? Because in COVID-19 pandemic, if some clinical trial subject is already exposed to COVID-19 virus, then that particular subject may have antibodies against the COVID-19 virus. Okay. So in that subject, if the vaccine is administered, vaccine is not going to give any additional enhancement in antibody level. So that kind of subject cannot be enrolled. But after enrollment, at certain period, the antibody level has to be achieved by administration of vaccine. And based on the level achieved, the number of booster dose requirement can be evaluated, and based on that, the results are submitted to the regulatory body.
Okay, sir, one more question in two ends. This, I think you have this one now, Dave.
Yes, yes, I am able to see the question. Yes, I am reading the question. Does old manufactured vaccines or any formulation faces defamation error after getting the certificate for marketing what happened to the manufacturer or clinical trial in redone. Now it all depends on what is the legal status of the defamation. Now, if defamation is carried out by some private party, okay, then that defamation has to be endorsed by the regulator. In each and every developed country, there are authorities, drug regulatory authorities. So, if some private party has filed a defamation, face a defam. What exactly you mean by defamation? I'm not able to get this question properly. Actually, does old manufactured vaccine or any formulation faces defamation error after getting the certificate from marketing? What happened to? Sorry, I'm not able to understand this question. If you could elaborate your question. Or you can note down my email address, my phone number. You can send it to me on my WhatsApp. This is my WhatsApp number.
Thank you very much, sir, for the interactive session. And with this, we complete all the sessions of Charuset Endowment Chair. Now I request the coordinator of this program, Dr. Gayatri Patel, to deliver the presentation.
Thank you, madam. Now today we are at the completion of all these 5 days endowment chair. So I would like to present the report and vote for thanks. So good evening to everyone, respected Jignesh sir and dear participants. I, Dr. Gayatri Patel, Professor, Department of Regulatory Affairs, RPCP, and coordinator of this event, feels an honor to present the event report. Our event, Charuset Endo Chair, which is the endowment fund created by Charuset University, and at RPCP, we organize the endowment chair activity every year with an objective to provide the platform to our students for interactions with the eminent speakers, scientists, and professionals. With this view, this year an endowment chair was organized on the theme Regulatory Considerations for Pharmaceutical Development, a Global Scenario. During the 1st to 5th June 2021, around 250 participants, includes research scholars, faculties from various educational institutions, and industry personnel, participated in this event and made this program a grand success. Learned persons from all over the India has provided their in-depth knowledge on the topic assigned to them. Very first day, on 1st June, Ranjit Barsikar sir, CEO, QBD International, Quality by Design, and CGMP Consulting, editorial board member, Journal of Generic Medicine UK, addressed the gathering and shared his view and experiences on various aspects on quality by design principles, including guidelines, UBD compliances, current scenario, and future challenges. His talk was remarkable and very informative. Followed by the first day, on second day, 2nd June 2021, Dr. Hardik Soni, Senior Manager, and Ms. Bijal Shah, Assistant Manager, R&D, Vasu Research Center, Baroda, delivered a talk on regulatory scenario of herbal medicine, herbal supplement, and herbal cosmetics, an Indian and global scenario, respectively. Both of them touched the very minute aspects on current regulation of herbal and as well as supplements. Third day, Ms. Meena K. Shah, Pharma Quality and Regulatory and Pharmacovigilance Advisor and Auditor, Regulatory and Project Management at Partner, Tanmi Associated, Mumbai, discuss about the essential of regulatory compliances and management and share her wide spectrum of knowledge. On 4th day, 4th June, Dr. Rajasri Ojha, Founder and Director, Raj GPRAC Private Limited, Mumbai, India, had presented her view on the importance of understanding the various types of drug application along with ECDD submission network. On final day, Dr. Jignesh Patel, today Senior Director and Head, Clinical Pharmacology and Co-Laboratory, CBCC Global Research, delivers his experiences and knowledge about the role of clinical pharmacology as regulatory perspectives. His talk was very informative and covered the things in form of practical orientation. So this is all about the brief of our today, our entire 5 days activity report. Now I'm proposing the vote of thanks. On behalf of organizing committee, it is my privilege to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. My heart fills with lots of gratitude and respect for our distinguished speakers for not only sparing their valuable time for us to grace this occasion, but also for enlightening us with their commendable talk on the subject. Thanks all of you for clearing our concepts and enhancing our understanding pertaining to the various aspects on regulatory principles. You have indeed put best of your efforts to make this even unforgettable event. Really, we are highly obliged all the speakers. My heart goes out to thank our respected delegates for accepting our invitation, attended to this event, and encouraging the morale of speakers by their august presence and enthusiasm. Without your kind presence, we could not accomplish this event. Next, I would like to thank our management who provided us fund and all support to organize the event. Thanks goes to our principal, Sir Dr. Manan Rawal, for leading and inspiring us in working towards the goal of conducting this event. We are thankful to him for his huge support at all the times. I would like to thank all the members of an organizing committee and faculty members of RPCP for the direct and indirect support to make this event a grand success. We are grateful to IT committee members for helping us to arrange all the online sessions through Zoom platform, and all the sessions live on YouTube. I sincerely apologize if I have missed out on anyone. Thank you again, all of you, and we wish you all the corporations in our future event also all the best.
Thank you, madam. And with this, we complete finally the Charuset Endowment Chair at RPCP. I thank all the delegates for attending this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.